All right, the times are very urgent, so I have to keep taping and go as fast as possible here. Very little time to waste. Spent a sleepless night, mostly. Very intense difficulties. Was able to work through them. So it's just been an extraordinarily intense morning so far. And everything is being brought to light, and I'm being under a lot of pressure. And I know it's go time, so I have to, you know, make these right decisions and such, which I have done, which I've been able to do. And I can't please everybody. There's no question. You can't please both truth and lies. It's impossible. If you try to do that, you'll be disloyal to both, and it means you'll end up with confusion, which serves only to what? Hide options, which prevents us choosing truth. So we end up defaulting to this continual engagement with lies. So you cannot split people's attention. And this is the problem that I was having. I said, wow, I was saying, I don't want to try to hog the spotlight or anything. You know, it's like, wow. But keep in mind that I have met with Jesus. I did have a conversation, I couldn't quite remember what it was when I woke up, but I'm sort of working it out into consciousness right now, and I do understand the situation, and I've kind of been waiting to see, is this really a go? You know, is this really a go? And it seems like it really is a go. So Jesus needs a little bit of help. People are frightened to approach him and ask for advice directly and sit with him directly. And so he says it's helpful for people if there's someone else that also has authority, but not quite the intense authority that they see invested in me. And that's why the whole apostolic plan was put in place, is that people go to the apostles. The early church was based on people going, for the most part, to apostles. And then that apostolic succession became what we call the Roman Catholic Church. And I've been saying over and over again that the church age is over, that the Pope has officially excommunicated him. How could I do that? Well, I did it with good reason. And what I'm saying is that apostles are those who've actually met directly with Jesus and can relate directly instead of having an intermediary. The Pope is an elected functionary of the apostolic succession. Doesn't require that he's actually met with Jesus directly. Apostles have higher authority than any Pope, actually. And so when I say that the apostolic age, the end times apostolic age is here, that means that Jesus is back, and there are those who are meeting with him and been able to relate directly. I'm able to relate directly to some extent. So that means Jesus let me know. That means that you are part of the, you know, apostolic, you're part of the apostleship, you're an apostle, which means you have higher authority than the Pope, which is true. And I've been criticizing the Pope and excommunicating him because he is taking the church in the wrong direction. Now, I've been checking this out and double-checking, and going to church yesterday. There's a really quite extraordinary stuff happened in church. And it became very clear what's going on in the church. Our priest has officially retired. Very, very, very good priest. The new priest is pretty much a comedian and gets people laughing and restless and moving. And then we had some person right in front of us who was constantly gesturing and making and talking and agitate and moving about like this, just, you know, like super agitated, but in a very religious way. But the truth is that the whole purpose of going to church is to practice silence, sitting still in silence, because only in so doing can you actually see beyond words what the situation really is. And this morning, as in silence, I'm able to see what the situation is. This is the key. You have to see it for yourself, and your mind has to be clear, and words get in the way. You can listen to somebody else, but you need to be sitting quietly and still. And the church has been turned by the Pope away from this, and the news about the Pope is that he is now setting up a conference with some environmental radical feminist who is going to have a conference with the cardinals and help lay out a blueprint for an all-out assault upon global warming. Okay, now this is all very well and good if someone wants to do this. Okay, he should resign and maybe be the head of the United Nations, okay, and do it there. He has absolutely no business doing it as the vicar of Christ. The Pope should be calling for a worldwide campaign of silence and stillness. And if that were to happen, if the church was turned that way, that would happen, you know what would happen? We would find out that we don't even need this world. That's what we'd find out. This world is a portal to escaping this universe altogether. Okay, that's what this world wants to be used as. Okay, it says, please use me as a jumping off point to be free of this universe. Instead, the Pope is saying, my God, we got to make plans for to be occupying this planet for, you know, time immemorial, and we're going to have problems if we don't frantically tackle this. So what he's doing is he is absolutely turning the church away from it, the purpose that Christ intended it to be for, which is to practice silence. Now, we have a tremendously difficult time with this because the goddess, which is the one who invites us to dance with electromagnetic energy, which is false energy, which is a dream light. It's not true light. It has nothing to do with what we really are, this electromagnetic universe. The goddess is just our own desire to remain engaged with this dream of arrogance. And so this goddess is like a dance partner who invites us to dance, says, hey, let's dance with electromagnetic energy. And so she gets us dancing with it and gets us involved in it. And we feel that we can't stop the dance because, you know, you don't want to humiliate your dance partner. She's asked me to dance. I got to keep dancing until the music stops. Well, you get so tired and sick of it. You say, I want to stop. She goes, oh, okay, here, take a rest. But what kind of rest do you get, does the goddess give you? The goddess gives you a rest in depression, in despair, in lethargy, in fatigue, in sickness, and in death. That's the rest she gives you. And then this is so painful and suffering for you. You say, oh my gosh, I just got to go back to dancing. And then she said, pulls you into another dance. This is how it works. She's the great trickster, the great inviter to the dance that you don't really want to be invited to. And so she seems to have so much authority, you can't turn her down. But the Jesus and the apostles of Jesus have greater authority than the goddess and can give you permission from their authority to sit in stillness and sit in silence and not talk. And when you do that, your mind begins to clear up, the clouds begin to clear up, and you begin to actually see. You begin to actually see, say, whoa, I can actually see that, what's going on in terms spiritually. You'll be able to see spiritually, but it's actually a spiritual situation that we're in, and you begin to see that. It's very difficult to do it when you're talking. And so I have a difficult role because I have to both see it and talk. But this requires extensive training, which I have had. It is exceedingly difficult. So, and yet the world needs a permission from authority to do this because they think, wow, how can I go contrary to the goddess? She's insisting I keep dancing with this electromagnetic energy. And I don't feel like, you know, I feel like if I don't, I'll be annihilated. Because keep in mind, electromagnetic energy looks at clear light, the formless clear light of reality, and it cannot penetrate it. It can't see it at all. And so it sees it as total darkness, and it sees it as annihilation, like an abyss. It sees reality as an abyss, so it thinks if you don't keep dancing, you're going to fall into an abyss. So people are very nervous about this. Now, what I've been recognizing in church and various places for quite some time is this odd phenomenon, and I recognized it yesterday very strongly, is that I'm just sitting there paying attention to the priest and what's going on, and then I'll take my attention off and I'll just for a minute, and then I notice that somebody is like just staring at me from a distance are just like staring at me like this. Oh, there's hundreds of people in the church. Why are they staring at me? And then I looked over at another place, and someone else like staring at me. And when I see them, they kind of turn their head like that. Like, oh, I wasn't looking at you. I said, why the heck are they staring at me? That's ridiculous. And this has been going on and on and on. And it's like they're trying to pay attention to me and not the priest. They say, why attention to me? Pay attention to the priest, you know. And this is it's like, wow, what is going on here? And so what Jesus explained, what the Holy Spirit explained is that the church is no longer giving permission to be silent. It does no longer get exercising its authority to give absolute permission to arrive in silence, to be silent, to arrive in silence, to leave in silence, and remain in silence while you're there in between. Okay, absolute permission to do this. What people are desperate for is permission to do this, and somehow these people somehow are sensing something in me, and they're turning to me and says, maybe you'll give me permission to be silent, you know, because of course I will. So this is a possibility. What I'm here for is to give people permission to be silent using the apostolic authority that I have. I've met with Jesus. I'm able to relate directly, not through some intermediary. I don't have to go to his mother and talk to her, and then she goes talks to him, and then he goes talks to her, and then she talks to me. I don't need that. I can go directly to Jesus. I'm not frightened or intimidated. I'm a little nervous, sure, because my understanding is still limited. My clarity is still limited, but I'm in the ballpark enough where I feel, you know, comfortable. So after, you know, a lifetime of absolute intense effort, 4 years of all-out emergency effort that cannot even be explained, it would damn it with faint praise. So I feel that what the Holy Spirit told me is that there are lots of people who are desperate for permission to be still and silent so that they can begin to see through the falsity of this universe, actually. And they want that permission. And I'm capable of giving them that permission. Jesus said, will you help me out? Because they're too afraid to go to me directly. Like, you know, so will you give them permission and give them an opportunity just to sit quietly with you, just sit quietly in silence. Now, I can say something, but that's okay. But what they really need is they need no pressure to speak whatsoever. No pressure to speak whatsoever. No pressure to express themselves whatsoever. Now, when we were leaving the church yesterday, we always just leave in silence, you know, which is what you're supposed to do. And this person who's this very agitated and talking and they waylaid us and started talking about all the stuff, issues and everything. And finally, we were extricated ourselves from this. Very nice person, but it pointed out to me this is what's going on, and the church is trying to evangelicize itself because they're losing tremendous amount of people to the evangelical, especially the Hispanics, and so they're trying to promote this idea of walking about the church and introducing yourself to other people, talking about, you know, yourself and what you're, and asking for prayers for you and all this kind of stuff. This completely interferes with the higher purpose of sitting still and sitting quietly and feeling there's no pressure on you to talk whatsoever, and giving you the opportunity to your mind to clarify. Totally disrupts it, and then trying to leave, you're supposed to leave in silence too, and this person completely disrupted that too. So I could see the disruption, and then they called out to the priest and asked a question, which has never been done before. I mean, all the time, no one's ever done that. This person said, I can't help myself, I got to ask you this question, and talking, the priest was like stunned by it, and this was the Holy Spirit showing me this is the way it's going. They want to turn it into an evangelical sort of situation. And the Pope has turned it over to the goddess, said Eve is blameless, it's Adam's fault. Meaning turning over to the goddess of this universe, electromagnetic energy, our desire to remain engaged with that. He's already done that. And now so he's now telling the whole church they need to create a bold, intense global campaign to tackle global warming, and he's calling these radical environmentalists to help him with this campaign. And this is what he's turning the attention of the church to. This is an anathema. This is an anathema. This absolutely deserves excommunication. Absolutely. If excommunication should be used at all, it should be used on a pope who is an anathema, who turns out to be a rogue pope. That's where it should be used. And who has the authority to do that? Well, an apostle would certainly have the authority to do that. Apostles are closer to Jesus than any elected pope. So I've excommunicated the pope, and out of respect for the church, I've made him pope emeritus. Okay, now, that means that people in the church are free to turn to apostolic authority to regain that permission to sit in silence and stillness and silence, which is the very best method to gain clarity. It's absolutely crucial, and as we practice here in our videos, full stop in the wow. I'll talk for a while, then I'll be quiet for a while. We take breaks. So you have absolute permission to sit quietly and still as you listen to this, as you experience it. And what I do is I bring up truth that should shake you, you know, shake your beliefs and gradually evaporate false beliefs. And you have permission to just sit quietly and don't say anything. Don't have to even sing. Don't have to sing. You don't have to get up and socialize and introduce yourself to anybody. Come in silence, leave in silence, and be silent in between is the best advice that I have for you. And you have my permission to do that. Absolutely have my permission to do that. So I'm just helping out Jesus as requested. This is what I want to do. Jesus knows what it's all about for sure. Knows what it's all about for sure. Now this isn't the only way that Jesus be helped out. Others will help out in, you know, different ways, most likely. But this is what I can do. This is what I've been asked to do. And this seems to be what people are looking towards me for. They might say, whoa, this church is getting out of control here. And it really is. It really is turning into a comedy club. The atmosphere is absolutely shifted. No question about it. And you've lost that solemn dignity, that feeling like I'm coming here because I'm just going to, this shields me from the world and I can be silent. Ultimately, we take refuge in the grace of God. There is this refuge from the universe that we can experience even while here, where the electromagnetic light cannot penetrate it, really, cannot affect it, disturb it in any way, where there's just this undisturbed peace. That we, like a portable paradise that we can have, and we take refuge in the perfect darkness, take refuge in the perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness that the electromagnetic light cannot penetrate it, cannot disturb it, cannot get it to dance to its tune at all, at all. So, this is the direction that I'm going to. Now, the Holy Spirit pointed out to me, look, the problem you've had is the people being ambivalent, that they're used to turning back to the goddess of the dance and say, you know, and it's like, you know, do you really have the authority to exclude the goddess of the dance from, you know, and you have to, because split attention is going to lead to just level confusion, mixed message, and it won't be successful or effective at all, and you just end up with confusion, which only benefits lies. So the Holy Spirit said, you have to accept sole responsibility for this. You cannot have some co-responsibility, someone who represents the goddess or even represents anything. People have to feel that they are getting authority, straight authority, and it's not divided. It's not divided. That's very important. They want to know that they definitely, here's where the authority is coming from. And it keeps them, their mind from, it keeps the goddess from being able to interfere, do her game and invite them to the dance. You say, no, I know where my authority is coming from. Okay, it's very important. And that's the part that I was, you know, like saying, wow, do I really want to, you know, do that? You know, I said, but it's necessary. It's necessary. So I'll do that. I'm not going to share any authority with anyone on this issue whatsoever. I'm going to give direct permission myself. I'll take full responsibility for it. And people will know where the authority is coming from. And there's no possibility that way of the goddess insinuating herself into the situation and subtly getting people to start dancing to her tune, to her dance, which is the dance of this universe. Okay, the dance of this universe is not the dance that really satisfies us. And we've recently had some situations in the world where people are all euphoric and say, wow, it's time to dance. Let's party. Let's dance. This is great. Well, they're not being condemned. I'm not condemning. I'm saying that you will most certainly get buyer's regret, some sooner, some later. But all eventually, always, the dance of this universe never satisfies us. Never. Never can. Never can. So you get buyer's remorse, you get regret, and then what do? You go looking for permission to be quiet and still, and that enables your mind to see through the charade, this massive self-deception of arrogance. And you are able to see through it. When you are able to quiet your mind, you're able to see through it. And once you see through it, wow, its power over you begins to quickly dissipate. Not instantly, usually, but it begins to crumble. The power over you, it begins to crumble as you see through it. So all those who are all out celebrating right now, thinking, man, it's party time in this world, you know, they will maybe wake up soon someday and say, you know what? That's not really where it's at. I've changed my mind. So we welcome everybody back. Everybody back is always welcome with open arms back to the truth. And is welcome to sit in silence. That's how it is. And everybody is going to be saved without question. They've already been saved. We're just honoring time right now. But so there are those who are really seeming to really say, wow, dancing with the goddess is where it's at. But they may find out that the dance gets too wild for them. They say, you know what? I think that was a mistake. And I understand that. I totally understand that, having been through that myself. So by all means, you can change your mind. You're always welcome. You have my full permission to change your mind at any point. Say, you know what? I think I'm going to, not only am I going to sit this out, but I'm not going to sit it out in depression, anxiety, fear, despair, you know, illness, death, and all that. I'm going to sit it out in silence and stillness and allow my mind to clarify. I'm going to sit it out in right spiritual practice. I'm going to start taking refuge in right spiritual practice. And so, this is what I see. We don't need to worry about condemning anyone. They'll all come back to truth at some point. Guaranteed. There's no doubt about it. No one will ever be lost. It's only a dream. How could you can be think you're lost in a dream, but the dreamer is not really lost. So again, this world, we're not here in this world to head out into the stars of this universe. Okay, we're here in this world to exchange this universe for another universe. Okay, which is not based on what we would call stars and electromagnetic light and all of that. And this universe is an intermediate step back to true formlessness, true pure ideaness, pure essence idea, not energy, not electromagnetic light, none of that. So this world is a portal to another universe, not that we should be spending all our time and attention on saying, how do we, you know, start visiting the other planets and the stars, and how do we keep dancing with the universe, you know, dancing with the goddess. No, that's not what we're here for. We're here to let go of that. That's what the world really wants. If you really truly ask the world, they say, I don't want to keep remaining a world. Liberate me too. Liberate the universe. The universe doesn't like being a universe. The dream doesn't like being a dream, really. We don't like it, you know? And so use the world the way the world can give the new purpose to the world. This is a jumping off place to a new universe, actually. We're done with the old one. Everybody's absolutely tired of it. You know, we're just desperately trying to pretend not so. And there's some that are pretending stronger than others, you know, and taking drugs and music, sex, drugs, music, trying to try to say, I gotta keep dancing, you know. Come on, I need the beat, you know. Let's go disco and let's keep dancing. Let's go raving, you know. We got to keep dancing here. So, you know, no flowers, no music, no food. Just people come in silence, leave in silence. In between, they're silent. It's very simple. Really, just three things to remember. You arrive in silence, you leave in silence, and in between you're silent. And this is what people are desperate for. And they're not, you know, they're not getting the permission. Where do you get the permission in this world? Who has the authority? So I have to exercise my authority. If I don't exercise my authority that I have, then nobody's going to go for it. They say, well, you know, the goddess is just too strong right now in the world, for sure. The dance is, the invitation to the dance is so strong. You know, they call it the last dance. I guess the Grateful Dead are doing their invitation to the last dance now. And, you know, and they're saying, come on, let's not stop dancing. You know, let's keep grooving with electromagnetic energy here. So, this is just what has happened. This is just what has happened. I was not really, you know, it's just the effort to clarify, allowed me to then, you know, overcome my fears of direct contact with Jesus. Most people are very afraid of direct contact, which is why they go through an institution like the church. They're too frightened, they're too ashamed, they think they're going to be thrown into darkness. You know, they haven't seen it yet. They're still working with concepts and words. But the mind has to be able to see the situation. And when you see it, you don't need words, you can just see it. You say, wow, now I see it. Well, you know, what's going on? Holy cow. I see that reality is not darkness at all, really. It's only that way from the standpoint of delusion. Because the fake light cannot affect the true light. Fake light says, well, the true light's darkness, because I can't penetrate the darkness. It must be total darkness, you know. So say, yes, I am that total darkness. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Embrace that fact. I am that perfect darkness. And this is, of course, an expression of your freedom from this universe, actually. So people may just want to sit, now just like sit somewhere, you know, and they'll just sit quietly. And I might say a few things, see how it works out, I don't know. But I won't be sharing any authority with someone else. It's not my authority to do so. I was asked directly by Jesus to do this. I was not asked or given any authority to choose other people to, you know, help me out as far as be the center of authority. I was not given any such mandate by Jesus at all. This job is for one who's able to directly relate with Jesus. Have to be an apostle to do this. And the apostle, I do not have the authority to share my authority, so to speak, and say, okay, you can sit in for me and you can do it too, or, you know, that kind of thing. I don't have that authority, so I won't be doing that. Now, the goddess may send someone and say, you have to share authority, and I have to say, no, I'm not sharing authority with the goddess at all. That would completely spoil the effectiveness of it. This apostolic authority trumps the authority of a goddess, completely trumps it, and that's the whole point of it. As people have to recognize that the goddess doesn't have any genuine authority over us whatsoever. Just like a dream has no authority over the dreamer whatsoever. What imagine if the dream came to the dreamer and says, hey, we got to share authority, you know. What kind of nonsense is that? That just completely confuses the situation. And of course the goddess wants to usurp the attention that may be given to me, like that I'm giving the permission, so people are okay. But, and the people are just, what they're focusing on is do I have the right to be quiet? And they see yes, they keep focusing on that. So great, I'm gonna be quiet then. It's not like an idolizing or worshiping somebody. It's just that I want to make sure that I do not, that my constant attention wander from the permission that I'm experiencing. That's what's going on. And of course the goddess wants to come in and usurp that attention after her dance. And so if people are putting their attention on someone, the goddess will kind of come in and say, you know, hey, let me be co-authority here. And then gradually she gets the attention over to her, and then she starts dancing with everybody, you know, starts to dance again. That's what happens here. That's the problem. And the goddess is being extremely aggressive right now, extraordinarily aggressive, insisting that everybody dance. I think she's really worried about Jesus having come back already. She's feeling, you know, the pressure, like, uh-oh, you know, we might lose interest in this dance, which we certainly are. We already have lost interest in it. We just don't feel like we have the authority ourselves to tell the goddess no. So we need someone who does have, we feel has that authority, temporarily has more authority than we do, to help us out. And so Jesus certainly has the authority, and that he then gives this authority to his apostles, those who are willing and able to meet with him directly, and then they give that authority out to those who want to sit quietly, which is the whole purpose of church in the first place. So this is what I'm experiencing and seeing. And, you know, I'm not really used to it, so I have to get used to it. And just start out and get familiar with it, get used to it, that's all. It gets better as you go along. If you pay attention, you really care about it, and your intention is to be more and more effective, then that's what will happen. So I've already been doing this with, the reason why I do taping like this is so there isn't any interaction. People don't feel like they have to talk, dialogue and talk. That's what's so important, is the not talking is what's important, is the discipline to don't talk. You don't have to switch your mind over to words. Those who are in the camp of the goddess are experts at switching your attention over, back into words, calculating, thinking, how do I spell this word? How do I spell this? How many, you know, quantitizing, what's the name of this? That shifts attention over to talking, speaking, and you lose the seeingness, the abstract seeingness. There's part of your mind that is so adept at this abstract seeingness, okay? And it can see the totality of the situation as it is and recognize it's a spiritual situation. Okay, and they can see how to undo it, can actually see how to get free of it. But the calculating mind, the thinking, calculating mind, the emotional mind, the emotional, intellectual mind can interferes with this. It interferes with it. So, now the goddess is very good at sugarcoating the dance to make it seem like it's very spiritual. And it's very great trickster. The goddess is truly the great trickster. And there are some teachers in the world, maybe they're authentic authorities. Some of them maybe are just great tricksters. You know, maybe, probably both are here in the world now. And they can just churn out spiritual buzzword phrases, and sugarcoat the whole situation. It's like put icing on this electromagnetic cake, as if now the cake should satisfy you. Well, no, it doesn't. It doesn't matter how you sugarcoat this cake, it still tastes terrible. Okay, it still will always taste terrible. So we're not here to sugarcoat anything. We're here to help people be silent and see for themselves. See for themselves. See for yourself. You can see for yourself. Absolutely you can. If you give yourself permission. If you feel that you have the right to do so, you can see for yourself. And at the very least, you can get confidence that there is a way to see for yourself. If you continue on with this quietness and stillness, you absolutely can see for yourself. If you want to know an example, for example, of someone, I talk about this taking refuge, okay? You absolutely can take refuge within the grace of God. And that the electromagnetic world then cannot disturb you at all. It cannot disturb you at all. You're completely calm, completely at peace. A great example is Ramana Maharshi. A great example. Okay. Nothing disturbed him. His peace was undisturbed. Nothing could disturb him. And you could see this undisturbed, great calm and bliss. And it was, you could tell, this was not the dance of the electromagnetic universe at all. Not at all. And we can actually experience the same sanctuary, same peace as that. We absolutely can. And we will. At some point, we absolutely will. The universe will not touch us. Yes, I am that perfect untouchability. Yes, I am that perfect untouchability. And we can actually see, it's possible to actually see how this is possible and recognize it with that aspect of our mind, which is this abstract seeing, reasoning capacity, which the dance of this universe interferes with so badly, so badly, so badly. And sugarcoating with all sorts of non-dual phrases and all this kind of stuff. Sugarcoating is sugarcoating. I mean, there's nothing wrong with non-dual talk as long as it's not sugarcoating. But it is possible to turn it to the, you know, to be sprinkling sugar on the electromagnetic universe and saying, hey, this, have fun. This is where you have fun. So that's not where we're at all. And that's not where Ramana Maharshi was at all, actually. You could feel this vast, radiant peace, presence. And that gives people permission to be quiet. See, everyone that came to him was quiet. They just sat quietly. He didn't say anything, hardly. And they felt this enormous permission to be quiet. And their minds began to clarify. And they began to experience and to see directly for themselves this great peace that transcends the universe. Absolutely transcends the universe. Absolutely it does. Just as the dreamer transcends the dream. And in this seeing, then they gained this inner conviction, this true inner conviction, which was beyond words. Now keep in mind that the whole purpose of Jesus is journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. Okay, journey beyond words. Let's see if I can dial up something here. If this will work. Journey beyond words. So at some point you have to sit, practice sitting quietly, silently, and just seeing what you can see abstractly in a total manner, that the seeing doesn't require words. The seeing doesn't require words. Okay, we will see if this will go. Maybe it won't. Anyway, it's journey beyond words. It is journey beyond words. The graphic will not pop up. Maybe it'll pop up when I do that. But journey beyond words. I put it on the graphics of Jesus. Journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. The seeing is greater than the words. The seeing is greater than the words. You have to get to seeing in order to be liberated. You have to get to seeing. You cannot remain dancing with words. Words still remain a dance with the goddess to some extent, you see. There is this dancingness of words. Okay, and you have to see beyond that. Words have no intrinsic real meaning. They're always, hey, let's dance, let's dance, let's do this dance of words. And that doesn't work. So, again, I'm asserting apostolic authority. That's higher authority than the Pope. Okay, it's higher authority. So, those who, for instance, Catholics can feel they have a right. If they want to sit quietly and still, they have the right to do that. Anybody has the right to do that. Apostolic authority is a direct authority, okay, from Jesus. It's not based on interpreting words in a book or anything like that. It's actual meeting directly with Jesus, and Jesus suggesting, would you do this? Could you help me out? And saying, okay, I'll give it a try. I'll give it a try. See how it goes. That's apostolic authority. And that's all we really need in the world. That's all we really need. It's just the permission. People feel they have the permission to be quiet. Okay? That is what people cannot do right now in the world. They cannot be quiet. They cannot be still. Not truly quiet or truly still to the point of actually seeing. You know, they might practice meditation and yoga and stuff, but that's just physical, discipline. This quiet and stillness here is to the point of actually seeing what needs to be seen. This is what we're talking about. Seeing through the whole scam of this universe is what we're talking about. Telling the goddess, you'll not only take a rest or vacation, you'll take sanctuary from her. She can't invite you to dance anymore. She can't even touch you. Okay? She cannot touch you. And any invitation to the dance falls on deaf ears. Absolute deaf ears. Could you imagine trying to invite Ramana Maharshi to dance? No. Fell on deaf ears. Many tried. Fell on deaf ears. The stillness remained absolutely adamant. Shining, like a great shining light. True light. So that's an example. So, if there are those who want to dance, they're out of luck here. They're out of luck. That's not what this purpose is for at all. Arrive in silence, leave in silence, and in between, remain in silence. Very simple. Exercise your right to silence. Exercise your right to silence. And shift your attention and your mind off of the calculating part of your mind to the abstract part of your mind. That is able to experience clarity. Is able to experience clarity and experience seeing. And don't think that you have to explain it to anyone in terms of where you're at right now. Okay. Eventually you'll be able to say something about it if you want to. Sure. But first, you have to really feel that you have the right to be silent. And this is what we're struggling with. Everybody here is mightily struggling with this. And I'm saying that the purpose of the church should be to make a great revival right now, to insist that everybody has the absolute right to be silent and to be still and to do absolutely nothing. And to do this for hours at a time, is absolutely have the right to do this and the permission to do this. This is not what the church is doing, so I have to exercise my authority, apostolic authority, to give permission to all the church, to all the people of the world. You absolutely have the right to remain silent, you have the right to remain still, and you have the right to do absolutely nothing for hours at a time every day. You absolutely have that right, and so you have my full permission to exercise that right, full permission to exercise that right now. Full permission to exercise that right now. And not a moment too soon, because the world is going completely cuckoo, of course. The dance is getting frenetic, of course, as we knew it would. So it is now time to exercise, our right to hear that you have permission, to accept the permission, and to start doing it. Say, hey, I've got the permission to do it. I got the permission to do it. Clarity Ross gave me the permission to do it. Or the Apostle Ross gave me the permission to do it. You can say Apostle Ross gave me the permission to do this if you want to. I can sit quietly. I can sit still. I don't have to do anything except to allow my mind to be very quiet and still. And not even recognize the world or think about the world or pay attention to the world. Just pay attention to this inner clarity. And it will bubble up and will bubble up, and you go, wow, wow, and then full stop on the wow. Just coast for a while, just coast for a while. Remain silent, just coast for a while. and you'll notice, wow, I do have a way to get free, isn't there? I see it. I see there's a pathway to freedom. Wow, I don't have to keep dancing. There's nothing that I have to do in this universe. I don't have to accomplish anything here whatsoever. In order to lead this universe, I don't have to accomplish anything to do that. I don't need the permission of this universe to lead this universe. Does a dreamer need the permission of the dream to stop dreaming or to dream a different dream? Is there some figure in a dream that the dreamer has to go to and get permission to change the dream? Say, gee, I'd like to change this dream, but I really need your permission, you know. Some dream figure in the dream. Is that true, or is that just absurdity? It's absurdity, isn't it? So in the listening is, I mean, the stillness and the quiet is not necessarily listening. This can filter in. But you feel the permission to be silent. It's not like you're some academic, like in a classroom, like, okay, I'm taking down the notes. Some teacher there taking down the notes. No, there's not a teacher. There's an apostle here. It's a different situation. The apostle, his main job is to give permission to be quiet and to allow your mind to go to expand into the abstractness of your being. It gives permission to do that. And so you give yourself permission, then you may come back to hear a little more, and then you give yourself permission, then you may come back and maybe hear a little more, and then you don't need to remember what's being said at all. It's you need to keep experiencing the clarity. There's no test given. There's no teacher. It's an apostle. It's a different situation. It's not an academic situation. If you end the situation, where you end the time where you can't remember a word that's ever been said whatsoever. You're just in this intense reverberation of wow. You know, then you used your time very, very effectively. Very effectively. And the wow is, hey, I can do this. I don't have to keep dancing with the goddess. I absolutely don't have to. I feel I can reach the authority. I know I have it within me. I just need to resuscitate it, you know. I've been taught to revile this inner authority I have over the dream as if it's evil, as if it will cause my annihilation. This is a total lie. Let's put it plain and simple. The goddess is a liar. Plain and simple. That's all the goddess is a liar. Okay. Of course, it's a hired liar. It's a made liar. We made the liar to lie to us, to keep us engaged with this dream, thinking that we had to stay engaged with it and we had no choice. This is absolutely not true. We have a choice. We absolutely have a choice. So we resuscitate that choice and we start to resuscitate and say, wow, I'm not as bad as I thought I was. It's like, this is great. This is just like, wow. I just realized that I'm not as trapped as I thought I was. Wow. I may not have to do as much as I thought I had to do to get free of this universe. Wow, I'm not really in debt to this universe. Wow, I'm not an indentured servant to this universe. Wow, this universe really doesn't have any authority over me whatsoever. Wow. I don't have to keep dancing. I don't have to keep playing these games. I can have something that reminds me of reality, actually. Free of symbols, free of belief, free of perception, free of form. I can have a dream that reminds me of that. And so this starts dawning upon us. And you just sit there and say, wow, don't say anything about it. See, when this hits you, don't say anything about it. This is what's so important. You have permission to remain quiet. You have permission to remain quiet. That is what's so important. Because when this hits you, you will just be floored. And you'll say, I don't want to say a doggone word. This is too precious for words. Anything I say is going to be damning with faint praise. This is too precious for words. You absolutely have the permission to remain quiet. And that is at the essential heart of success, of your success. Feeling you have that permission. Okay, very great. So, I have to do some work now. It's very intense time. I have to get this up for you so you have a chance to see it and consider it. And let's see what happens now. It's a great time, isn't it? And it's an intense time, so enjoy it. Very great.